Hi, my name's Alfie and I'd like to thank you very much for purchasing this DVD. During this next couple of hours, I'm going to explain to you a lot about how your body works on the inside, how to lose massive amounts of weight, how to fine-tune your exercise program so it can actually change the shape of your body within 2 to 3 weeks if you do your program every second day. Now, what I'm going to be talking about today is how to get your health back first. For those of you, if you're over the age of 40, you might be on certain types of medication. And when you're on medication today, that does not mean that your body is healthy. If you need to take drugs and medication to suppress a symptom, you need my help. And this is what we're going to be focusing on today. Now, my career started 13 years ago, originally in South Africa. I've always had a passion in health and fitness, and obviously I started out as an exercise coach or a personal trainer. And I had a lot of clients come to me about 3, 4, 5 times a week. And like most typical personal trainers, I'd make them exercise really hard. You know, you'd have to leave me within that hour you spent with me and you'd have to be in pain. You'd have to have a lot of muscles that were burning and aching and paining. And if you called me up the next day saying your muscles are really sore, I felt really good about that because then I did my job. I noticed though that after a few weeks of training with certain clients that they would be getting fitter and stronger, but they would not be losing any weight. Now, again, if you just look around you, you'd notice that people always gain weight around the same parts of their body, namely the stomach, hips and thighs for the ladies, and also the back of the arm and the bra strap area. More specifically for men, it's the stomach area right here and under the chin. Now, again, if you think that this is due to a lack of exercise, have you ever paid attention and looked at people who consistently do sit-ups and crunches in the gym? Do they have a flat stomach? For most of the time, they're going to have a very dysfunctional posture, first of all, and also on top of that, they're not going to have a flat stomach. And let's face it, who likes to do sit-ups and crunches on a daily basis? They're not the most exciting thing to do. Now, what I'm going to be showing you today is how to combine three concepts or three principles to get your body in exactly the way you want it to be. I would say if it was me, if I was you, and you were to implement the goals that I think everyone should be aiming for, is first of all how to increase your energy. For those of you that have ever tried to do anything new with regards to health and well-being, you might find that you're very good for doing it for maybe a week to 2 weeks, maybe maximum 3 weeks at a time, and then you get frustrated because most of the time you're not getting the results. So if you don't have the energy to commit to something and to see it through, chances are you're going to give up within the next few weeks, a few months maybe. So we want something that you can implement that's very, very simple, very, very slow paced, and that's going to give you enough energy to commit and to stick to it as well. We want you to start also seeing results really, really quickly, because if you're anything like me, I want to see my results immediately. I do not want to wait 3, 4, 5 weeks before I notice a change in my body. I want to see it within the next few days, 2 to 3 days max. And this is what I want to provide for you today. Same thing with your exercise. I don't want to go to the gym for weeks at a time and not notice a change within my body. Again, I want that instant feeling, that instant change. And this is all very, very possible if you combine all three of the things we're going to be talking about today. Now, I just want to take you back about 13 years when my career began. Like I said, this was in South Africa, and I'll never ever forget one of my first consultations that I had with a lady. Her name was Mary. Mary came to me, and she wanted to lose about 35 pounds. Pretty typical average weight loss for a woman of 38. She said to me that she did not feel comfortable wearing certain types of clothes. She didn't want to go to anywhere where she had to take off her clothes and get into like a swimsuit. So she didn't want to go to the beach or swimming pool or anywhere like that. She was really unhappy in the way she felt with herself. Her energy levels were low. She started taking the typical blood pressure and cholesterol medications. And it got to the point where she actually even felt embarrassed to take her clothes off in front of her husband. And this really started to impact her relationship, not just with her husband, but with her children as well. Because, I mean, the children were starting to be more active and she wanted to be more involved as well. And she just didn't have the energy for it. I saw her eyes filling up with tears as she explained her situation to me. And at that moment, I thought to myself, I'm going to do whatever it takes to help this woman get to where she wants to be. And like most personal trainers, I exercised and I exercised and I exercised this woman into the ground. And we noticed again, getting fitter, getting stronger, but she wasn't losing any weight. It wasn't until a few weeks later, I went to a seminar about peak performance. And the speaker was talking about a certain concept about how to get your body's pH balance back into where it should be. And how the body then will start to let go of the body fat that it's holding onto. When we started to implement these things with Marie, her literally body started to change shape overnight. Her energy came back again, her cheeks started getting rosy again, and her body really started to focus on getting back to a state of good health and losing weight as well. And we really noticed a lot of progress very, very quickly. Now, again, there are three things that we need to focus on in life in order to be healthy. And I'm going to explain this to you in my health triangle over here. Now, again, the first thing most people focus on when they want to lose weight and also when they want to become more healthy is exercise. The second thing most people want to focus on is dieting. I'm going to write dieting underneath my health triangle over here because this is not really the way we want to go. Ideally, you want to follow a good nutritional program. Dieting really doesn't work, and we're going to explain that in a few moments. Now, the cornerstone of my health triangle over here is what I'm going to be sharing with you in just a few moments. Now, the cornerstone of my health triangle constitute 50% of what we have to do in order to get our body back to a state of good health. Nutrition, 35%, and exercise, about 15% of what you need to do to get to a state of good health. Now, again, this might take you by surprise, but I'm going to explain this in just a few moments. So let's take exercise for example. How many of you have gone to the gym and you go onto the treadmill and you're on there for an hour, or you're in the cross trainer or any of those machines, you're on there for about an hour? You'll notice that the average person per hour burns about 350 calories while exercising on that piece of equipment. Now, for a pound of body fat, you will contain about 3,500 calories per pound of body fat, which means if you divide this up, you'll have to be on that cross trainer or treadmill for 10 hours to lose 1 pound of body fat. Now, how many of you would like to put in 10 hours of work to lose 1 pound of body fat? You can tell that this is not the best way to go about losing weight. So this is why exercise really isn't the best way to lose weight. When you exercise, your key focus should be to exercise to improve your posture and your postural balance. Now again, we're going to be talking about posture and a posturally balanced exercise program a little bit later on in this DVD. But for now, let's just say when you look at your body from the side, your head should be over the shoulders, shoulders over the hips, hips over the knees, knees over the ankles, so that your body is flowing nicely. If you've ever seen people with a forward-looking shoulder, that is not a very attractive look. Same thing with the ladies. You wear high heels and your butt sticks out because your pelvis has been tilted forward. This is something that you want to look at correcting with your exercise program. By running on the treadmill or the cross trainer, you will never, ever, ever correct those imbalances, and your body is never, ever going to look very good. So what you want to focus on when you exercise is to strengthen the long, weak muscles of your body, and you want to stretch out the short, tight muscles of your body. This is something I'm going to go into a little bit more detail a little bit later on in this presentation. So please remember that exercise alone is not there for weight loss purposes. Same thing with dieting. For those of you that have ever tried a diet, what happens when you go on a diet? There are tons of diets out there. Jenny Craig, Weight Watchers, Atkins, Pritikin, South Beach, all of the different diets. None of them seem to be giving you a perfect or long-term solution to your goals. So you start dieting and you start losing a few pounds. The average weight loss on one of these diets is about 10 to 12 pounds. Now what happens is you normally reduce the caloric intake when you're on a diet. So that means you're reducing the amount of energy that you're putting into your body. Now your body is made up of different tissues, but the two main tissues that we want to focus on with regards to weight loss is muscle and fat. Now muscle is a tissue that is metabolically active, which means it actually costs your body calories and energy to maintain that amount of muscle mass on your frame. Muscles is actually responsible for your metabolic rate. The higher your metabolism is, the more body fat you will actually burn throughout the day. Your body can burn fat the more muscle you have. Now, when you reduce the amount of energy you're putting into your body, essentially your body is now going into what we call a recession or a cost-cutting phase. So your body needs to reduce costs. So you don't have the energy to maintain the muscle mass. Muscle is more expensive to keep than fat, and the body simply says, look, in order for me to cut costs, I'm going to reduce the muscle mass on my frame. So what happens then? Once your body cuts down on the muscle, your metabolism goes down. So you've lost your 10 to 12 pounds and you reach that plateau, the dreaded plateau. So your body now doesn't lose any more weight anymore. You then get frustrated and you go back to eating the way you were before. So you put all of the extra calories back into your body, but your metabolism is now slowed down, which means you cannot burn that extra body fat off the system anymore. So not only do you gain back that 10 to 12 pounds, but now you're also gaining back an extra 8, 10, 12, 15 pounds, whatever it might be, on top of the original weight gain. Now, if you keep doing that over the course of your life, you yo-yo up and down like this, what do you think your weight is going to do over a 50-year period? Absolutely correct. It's going to skyrocket. This is why you get people getting to 50 and 60 and they're the size of a house, even though they feel that they've never really eaten that much food, because they're always on these yo-yo dieting. So please, hear me now, that these diets are destroying not only your ability to lose weight, but also your health. So you don't want to go on a diet, because once you take away the tea, look at what a diet is going to do to your body. Ultimately, it's slowing down your metabolism, the body is going to start to die. So we don't want to diet. We want to have a good nutritional program though. But if you look at nutrition, come on, it's not rocket science. You've got three macronutrients, namely protein, carbohydrates, and fats. Proteins are essential for you to rebuild neurotransmitting chemicals in your brain for cognitive functioning. You need to rebuild tissue and cells in your body. That's what protein's there for. Carbohydrates are there for energy. So your body, you've got a little bit of energy to burn throughout the day. Most importantly of that is proteins and fats, because again, cell membranes are made from fats. Hormones are made from fats. And your body needs fats to condition the hair and nails and so forth from fats as well. So protein, carbs, and fats, it's really not rocket science or difficult to figure out which macronutrients are responsible for what action in the body. But why is it that everybody's trying to manipulate these macronutrient proportions so much today in order to get to their desired weight loss? So let's think about it now. You've got today a hamburger and fries. Take that hamburger and fries and compare it to a hamburger and fries 100 years ago. If they are both exactly the same portion size, what would be the main difference between these two hamburger and fries? Think about it. What do they put in the animals and on the animals and on the plants today to keep away the bugs? All sorts of different things like hormones, additives, fungicides, pesticides. These are the different kind of things they're putting in the food today. So if you look at the hamburger today compared to a hamburger 100 years ago, both are exactly the same apart from all the chemicals that have been putting into the food today. So we've got a lot of chemicals that's entering our body today on a daily basis. Now chemicals, I'm sure you would agree with me, is not something very good that you want to put into your system. Now again, take the course of your life, 20, 30, 40, 50, whatever it may be, how many years of putting chemicals inside your body. Do you think that's going to be good for your health, or is it going to be bad for your health? I think most of you would agree that it's going to be bad for your health. Also, the other question you got to ask yourself is, what is this going to do for your fat burning ability? Now, if I wanted to undergo a process of removing chemicals out of my body, what would I call that process? Yep, you guessed it. Detoxifying my body. I got to go on a detox. Now, if you look at my triangle, you'll notice that 50% of what you need to do is to cleanse your body. Then you can start focusing on eating good food. Then we can start focusing on good exercise to get your body in shape as well. If you do not do these three in the correct order, you can actually possibly do your body a lot more harm than good. So please hear me now. Let's not compromise with our health. Let's get it done and let's do it right. What I'm going to be doing for you for the rest of the presentation is talking to you specifically about detoxification, why and how we need to detoxify the body, and what these toxins are going to do to your body. I'm going to show you how toxins in your system is directly responsible for causing your blood pressure concerns, your cholesterol concerns, arthritis, osteoporosis, and even cancer. So let's get down to it. Let's have a look now, first of all, at what is responsible for causing our ill health in our bodies. Toxins. Now, I'm sure you realize that when we talk about toxins, there are certain toxins that we get in every single day, and we're going to look at some of the obvious sources of toxins coming into the body. So like I said before, one of the main sources of toxins is the food that we eat, the air that we breathe, and the water that we drink and shower in. So let's think about it now. Let's look at our food source, because I mean, we all eat foods. So what is it that's really toxic in our food today? Now, I want to get away first from the toxic foods like meat and dairy and that. Let's think about just chemicals for the moment. Because at the end of the day, if you take the acidity or the toxic level of something like aspartame or sweetener and compare that to the toxicity level of steak, two completely different things. So let's look at the chemicals that they put into the food first, so we can get an idea of how much synthetic stuff we're getting into our system on a daily basis. Now we've got things like preservatives, additives, fungicides, pesticides, antibiotics, MSG, trans fats, colorants, and so forth. There's pollution in our air supply from secondhand smoke, car fumes, etc., from factory outlets, smoke into the atmosphere, and very, very toxic in our water supply is chlorine and very notorious fluoride. So if you have a look at these, just over the course of the next 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, if you absorb all of this on a daily basis, obviously that's not going to be very good for our health. So let's look at something like a preservative. Preservative is there to do one thing, to make your food last longer. Now, if you look at the function of your stomach is designed to break food down and assimilate that food. So you put something that's designed to last longer into something that's supposed to break down, put the two together, and what are you going to do inside your stomach? You're going to create a conflict of interest, right? Now, do you think that the food that's got a lot of preservatives in it is going to be broken down fairly easily? Or is it going to take your body a little bit longer to break down that food? Yep, you guessed it. It's going to take a little bit longer. Now, this food is going to go from the stomach to the small intestine and to the colon. Now, again, due to sedentary lifestyle, most people go to the toilet today once every 2 days, once every 3 days, once every fourth day. If you've ever gone for a colonic irrigation, you see what comes out after they flush that part of your body out. Some people have got a lot of waste inside of that part of their body. Now, if your body can't get rid of all of that waste, what is the body going to do, or what happens inside your body when that fecal matter doesn't leave your system? Yep, again, it's going to rot, it's going to ferment, it's going to create more poisons inside your body. Now, again, there's a lot of controversy about this subject, but if your body absorbs those toxins through the colon wall back into the bloodstream, back into the liver, and the whole process of cleansing and detoxification has to start all over again, that is auto-intoxication that's happening inside your body. So your body is literally poisoning itself. Now, again, a lot of doctors will tell you that you cannot absorb toxins through the colon wall. So I say to them, really, doctor, if you cannot give me my tablet orally, where else are you going to stick that tablet in so it can get absorbed properly? Again, the rear end. So whatever is in that part of your body absolutely will be able to be reabsorbed back into your body again. So preservatives, again, a very big cause of autoimmune disorders, where the body's immune system is so flared up that it starts to attack its own parts of the system, the joints, the muscles, whatever it might be. So preservatives, yep, very, very toxic to your body. So if you buy anything that's got a shelf life of more than 3 to 4 days, you know you're getting preservatives inside your body, and that is a risk factor for your health and well-being. Additives as well. Please, parents, if you've got children, look at the food labels. Food additives are directly responsible for ADD, ADHD, and all of those conditions now that suddenly really widely spread these days. Combine your food additives with sugar, and you've got a surefire way to make your kid run wild, not paying attention, and now having to go on that very poisonous drug called Ritalin. So please, sugar and additives are very, very toxic to your system. Fungicides and pesticides, again, some fruits and vegetables are sprayed with 7 different types of chemicals to keep the bugs away. If it's poison enough to kill an insect, it's poison enough to kill you. You're just not taking in large enough quantities. You're doing it a little bit at a time. Antibiotics is, again, stripping your digestive system of the good bacteria. Whether you're taking this in the meat that you're eating or whether your doctor is giving you antibiotics when you're now ill, you are literally stripping the good bacteria from your intestinal tract, and this is going to lead to a lot of problems later on in life. So please, antibiotics is extremely toxic to your body. Now, in our air supply, you don't have to be a genius just to look outside in your air or the city that you're living in. Smog, secondhand smoke, car fumes, you're breathing that into your body. However, remember please that your skin is the largest organ of your body, and it's a detoxification organ. So if you've got your skin in contact with the air, you'll be absorbing those toxins through your skin as well. Now, once again, if you're a little bit skeptical about your skin's ability to absorb, go and put 20 nicotine patches on your arms and legs and see how you feel within 10 to 20 minutes. Your skin absorbs whatever you put on it. So if you don't want to eat it or drink it, don't put it on your skin. Now, with regards to our water supply, 2 very notorious chemicals, namely chlorine and fluoride. Now, fluoride, again, ladies, if you compare or combine fluoride and caffeine, you're going to destroy your thyroid gland. Fluoride is directly responsible for attacking and destroying your thyroid gland, and also, very, very importantly, the pineal gland, which sits right behind the root of the nose here in your brain, which is said to be the seat of the soul, which, again, can disrupt your ability to connect with consciousness or God, if you like. This will be a subject on another one of my DVDs. So please remember that these toxins right here, they might not look like much on the board right now, but each of them have got a very, very profound effect on your immune system, your endocrine system, your overall health, and your ability to burn fat. Now, these are your obvious toxins that you're getting into your food, your air, and water. What about the things that you don't really think about on a daily basis? Now again, if you're sitting here watching this and you're on any type of drug or medication, you know you're getting a very harsh poison into your body. Drugs and medications are very, very harsh poisons to put into your system. Now again, what is that stuff we drink in the morning to wake up? Because now you've got no energy because your body's got to break this stuff down all day long and you don't have energy, you drink stuff like coffee. Coffee, very, very toxic to your body. Then you start noticing the bowls forming around your stomach. You look down, you're starting to put on weight. Now you want to reduce your calories. So what do? You take that stuff that looks like sugar, tastes like sugar, but it's not sugar. Yep, you guessed it. We call that artificial sweetener. Sweetness, very, very toxic to your body. I'm going to have a seat while I explain the rest. Then we've got stuff like deodorant, right? Please remember, you're putting deodorant under your arm, blocking your lymph nodes over here so your body cannot get rid of waste. Deodorants also contain aluminum hydrochloride, which is directly responsible for breast cancer. So please, ladies, if you've had breast cancer, don't put on deodorant. A toxic body stinks. A healthy body doesn't. Then we've got things like plastics. Go to the supermarket. Even if you buy fruits and vegetables, sometimes even organic fruits and vegetables, it's packaged in a plastic packaging or a polystyrene or styrene tray. Very, very toxic, these PCPs and PCBs, etc., coming into the human system. What about something like non-stick cookware, Teflon? Teflon cookware, very, very toxic to your body. Please remember that if you take your Teflon pan, you put it on the stove, you turn on the heat, that fumes coming off your pan is poisonous enough to kill a small bird within 10 minutes. Now, if you keep cooking your steak, cooking your eggs on a non-stick frying pan, what do you think you're going to be doing to your health again over the long term if it's poison enough to kill a small bird? Very, very harmful to the system. What about something like your toiletries? Right, ladies, you'll notice that your skin starts getting dry, so now we start putting moisturizers on. So you've got propylene glycol, parabens, all of these toxins that you're smothering your skin with, and again, is being absorbed into your system. The makeup that you might be using, the shampoo that you might be using. Some shampoos can be used as paint stripper, and now you're putting it on your head. Which part of the body is just underneath the skull over here, which is the driving force of your body? The brain. So please remember, what you put on your head should be actually chemical free. So again, let's continue. I'm not even speaking about alcohol, cigarettes, microwave ovens, cell phones, and all of those types of toxins. So just off the top of my head, I've listed a whole bunch of toxins over here. And you can see that if you absorb this over 10, 20, 30, 40 years, obviously that's going to be causing a big health concern inside your body. Now, a lot of people want to know, first of all, why is coffee toxic to my body? Because, I mean, you read in the newspaper one day that coffee is an antioxidant and it's very, very good for you. And there might be a hidden nutrient here and there somewhere in the coffee. But if you think about it, whenever you drink caffeine, the caffeine will combine with your stomach acid to form a very potent toxin called caffeine hydrochloride. This is a very, very potent toxin and carcinogen, and coffee also contains a chemical called trichloroethylene, which is a carcinogen used as a degreasing agent in the metal industry and as a solvent in the dry cleaning industry. So if you put 1, 2, 3, 4 cups of coffee into your body daily, how many ounces of trichloroethylene will you be absorbing throughout your life? Very, very potent carcinogens. Same thing with sweetener. Now, I've got some sweetener over here with me today, and for those of you that have ever bought new shoes, you'll notice that in your shoebox is a little packet that says do not eat. In that packet is something called calcium silicate, and the reason why it says do not eat is there for a reason, because this is a poison that can be harmful to your body. However, if you look at the back of your pink toxin over here, it says that one of the main ingredients is calcium silicate mixed in with your aspartame. So it's good enough for you to eat when it's in your sugar packet, but not when it's in your shoebox. So you've got to start asking yourselves a little bit of questions, because now when you look at these toxins, specifically sweetener, we're going to start getting into the depth of a different topic now that I'm going to be discussing with you next. Now, this is information I've got here from an FDA website. Now, for those of you that are familiar with the FDA, you'll know that it stands for Fatal Drugs Allowed, right? Now, it says here that if you are using aspartame and you've got headaches, depression, slurred speech, loss of memory, fibromyalgia, loss of sensation, or shooting pains in the lower legs, loss of equilibrium, vertigo, anxiety attacks, chronic fatigue, vision loss, retinal detachment, seizures, or heart palpitations, you may have aspartame disease. Many physicians and doctors will misdiagnose as multiple sclerosis what is simply methanol poisoning from aspartame mimicking MS. So in other words, what aspartame is doing to your nervous system is exactly the same as multiple sclerosis. It's breaking down the nervous system. Now, aspartame is a molecule composed of three components, namely aspartic acid, phenylalanine, and methanol. Once ingested, the methanol converts into formaldehyde. And once again, yes, formaldehyde is not going to make you live longer, but it is going to take you longer to decompose later on in your life. So please, stay away from this stuff. Now, the law has been changed so that they don't have to put aspartame on food labels anymore. Now it's a source of phenylalanine or a source of aspartic acid. Again, put the two together and you've got aspartame. So please, read your food labels and be careful. Now the FDA report 92 documented symptoms from using aspartame, including numbness, headaches, fatigue, vertigo, nausea, palpitations, weight gain, dizziness, irritability, anxiety, memory loss, blurry vision, rashes, seizures, blindness, tinnitus, joint pain, depression, hearing loss, spasms, addiction, loss of taste, insomnia, and weakness. Some diseases triggered by aspartame include brain tumors, multiple sclerosis, epilepsy, fibromyalgia, Graves' disease, chronic fatigue, Epstein-Barr, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, diabetes, mental retardation, lymphoma, birth defects, systemic lupus, and death. So once again, does this sound like something that's good for your body or bad for your body to put it inside of your system? Now, the reason why I'm sharing this with you is because a lot of the times when I say to my clients, okay, look, let's detox your body and let's look at a holistic way to do this without drugs and medications, and let's focus on actually getting you off those drugs and medications, I get met with a lot of skepticism. I need to go and talk to my doctor, and I don't know what my doctor will say. All of these excuses about why they can't detox. But we're very, very quick to put this stuff in our drinks, sweeteners, and look at that, what that's doing to your body. Now, the thing is that the medical community knows about this. They know what aspartame does to your body. The government knows what it does to your body because the FDA have approved that poison to be put into your food. And secondly, the food manufacturing firms as well know what that's doing to your body. And therefore, you get sick from eating their food, and therefore you go to the drug company to get your medication. So the question that you've got to start asking yourself is that who is actually supposed to be responsible for your health? Because I can promise you right now that if you don't do it, no one else will. Today, cancer is a $300 billion a year industry, so please make no mistake, you need to take responsibility for your own health, otherwise nobody else will. Now again, the question I'm asking you here is not to stop living life, because let's face it, you really cannot avoid most of these toxins coming into your body, at least at some point in your life. It's impossible for you to go and live in some organic bubble somewhere in Antarctica where there are no toxins. So the thing is that you've got to ask yourself is, when is the last time you've cleansed your body? So before I tell you how to cleanse your body, let's first have a look to see exactly what these toxins are going to be doing to your body on the inside. Now, the way in which your body runs and operates is on three different things. It's chemistry, electricity, and magnetism. Please remember that. Electricity, chemistry, and magnetism. All three of these is governed by something called the pH level of your body. Now again, this is very, very basic chemistry. Here you've got acid on this side of the scale. Acid has a positive charge at 0. 7 is neutral. Here we have alkaline with a negative charge at 14. So that's the pH scale. Now your body is very slightly alkaline in nature, but acid producing by function. So what that means is that when you are born, your body should be at 7.36. That is a normal pH level to be at. This is equivalent to your body's temperature. If you've ever had hypothermia and your body gets too cold, you realize that you risk the possibility of death. Same thing with running a high fever, the possibility of death. So you cannot be either too hot or too cold, or your body runs the risk of dying. Same thing here. You can't be too alkaline, you can't be too acid. You've got to be at 7.36 to be in a perfect state. Now luckily your body will very rarely get too alkaline, because every time you move a muscle, you stand up from a chair, you take a breath, there is an acidic byproduct that is produced by that action in your body. So this is why this balance will always be balanced out. However, the toxins that's entering our systems these days on a daily basis are highly acidic. Again, you've got something like aspartame, which is almost the same acidity level as battery acid from your car. And please remember that one can of diet soda takes about 3 months to be broken down inside your body. So please remember that. So most of these toxins are very highly acidic. So the more acid you put inside your body, obviously you're going to shift your body towards the acid side of that scale. Once you get to 7.2, this is now what we call a state of acidosis. This is now when your body is becoming too acid and it's going to start showing signs of breaking down. Please remember that when your body is showing signs of disease, simply put, the body is trying to say to you, hey man, you've got too much acid inside the system. I'm trying to let you know about the problem, and it's up to you to remove this acid to get your body to function properly again at 7.36. Now again, let's think about it. What can be a sign of acidosis? Let's start thinking about how things develop from, say, the age of 25 onwards. So now ladies start to begin to develop cellulite, spider veins, puffy eyes, blood pressure, cholesterol, diabetes, arthritis. All of these conditions are signs of too much acid inside your body. Symptoms are nothing more than your body's way of trying to tell you about the acid. Traditionally, how we try to solve this problem is to go to the doctor, and he pumps us full of more of medications, which are again very, very highly acidic. So now you're at 7 and a state of cellular death begins to occur. Cells die at 7, so the body doesn't want to get to 7. Blood pH cannot go below 7, you'll be in big trouble. Now, when cells die, you die, and then that becomes a problem for you. So I'm sure that all of you want to stay very far away from 7 when it comes to blood pH. Now, let's have a look what this is doing to your body on the inside. So just to illustrate my purposes here today, let's imagine that this is the average person by today's standards, right? So that's the stomach, and there's the feet. So most of you know that by today's standards, the average stomach is pretty big, right? So now you've got the fat cells underneath the skin. So that's your fat cells, and this is the stuff we all want to get rid of. Underneath the fat cells, we've got what's called the bloodstream. The bloodstream is your sap or your river of life, and it supplies oxygen and nutrients not just to the cells of your body but to the skin as well. Parallel to the bloodstream, you've got what is called the lymphatic system, which is equivalent to your human drainage system. So whether this is waste or acidic byproducts that your body produces itself, or whether it's acidic waste that enters from the outside, it will all go into your drain pipe, your lymphatic system, and gets taken to the liver, which is the processing plant, which is responsible for breaking down these waste products if they are naturally produced waste products. Then you've got the organ system of your body, kidneys, lungs, heart, etc. And then you've got the muscles and the bone structure. Nice, long, lean muscles. So this is pretty much what your body should look like on the inside. Now again, for those of you that's listening to this to learn how to lose weight, the organ that is responsible for breaking down your fat is called the liver. The liver is the only organ in your body that can break down your fat, turn it into energy so you can utilize that energy. So if you don't have a liver, nothing's going to happen to your fat. This is why it's so important to look after your liver. So more specifically, what happens is the liver releases a hormone called leptin. The leptin goes to the fat cell, turns it into sugar, so the muscles can use that sugar as fuel. So that's how your body turns fat into energy. So basically, if you're doing sit-ups and crunches, that does not mean that you're using the fat from your stomach here. It can be a fat cell from down here that's turned into sugar and then taken to the abdominal muscle via the bloodstream. So that does not mean if you do sit-ups and crunches, you're burning the fat from here. I hope that makes sense for everybody. So liver, very, very important. Now, I realize that this is a very, very simple description of the human body, but I'm going to try and keep things as simple for you guys at home so you can understand exactly what I'm trying to tell you here. Now, if you think about this guy over here, he now starts living life. So through no fault of his own, because no one's ever educated him about things like preservatives, additives, fungicides, pesticides, hormones, antibiotics, coffee, stress, fear, jealousy, all of these toxic emotions, toxic substances are now filling up the lymphatic system or the drain. Now, The lymphatic system is a very, very important part of your immune system. You've actually got four times as much lymph fluid in your body as you do blood. And if you look at your lymphatic system over here, it runs from head to toe. And you'll notice that here under the chin, under the arms, stomach and groin area, behind the knee, are these little filtration devices. We call them the lymph nodes. The lymph nodes are like the little filtration systems inside the lymphatic system. Now, once the lymphatic system gets blocked up with acidity, this is now going to start to affect your immune system. So now your body is going to become more susceptible to colds, flus, illnesses, and that kind of thing. Now your body really doesn't want that to happen to you. So in order to protect you against this, your body's simply going to take this acidity and it needs to put it away somewhere so it can deal with it at a later stage. Now imagine if your body dumps all of this acidity here in your organs, by your organs. It can start eating holes through your kidneys, liver, heart, lungs, etc., which is not going to be very good for your health. Same thing with the blood. If your body dumps all of that acid in the blood and your blood pH radically shifts to below 7, you're going to be in big trouble. So the only other area that your body can put this acidity in is around the fat cells of your body. So this now acid is being stored in the fatty tissue or the fat cells of your body. And these toxins go from being a water-soluble toxin to what we call a fat-soluble toxin. Now, for those of you that realize this as well, certain vitamins can be stored in your fat, in the fatty tissues, vitamin A and so forth, fat-soluble vitamins. The body does the same thing here with the acidity, and now you've got a fat-soluble toxin. Now, you can imagine that when this acid starts to eat away or damage that fat cell, it's not going to be very good for you because your fat cells are your primary fuel source. Please remember that. So your body's going to want to protect that fat cell. Now your body's solution to pollution is dilution. So simply put, your body's going to take fluid and put it around this fat cell to protect that fat cell against the acid. Essentially, your body's trying to dilute that acidity. So this entire area here is isolated with fluid. Now imagine that. Now you've got certain parts of your body that's filling up with fluid around the connective tissues. What's happening to the size of those areas? Exactly, they're going to get bigger. Same thing with your weight. Fluid has got volume and weight to it, so your weight starts going up. Now again, if you have a look at your lymphatic system, there are only very specific parts of your body where this process here can develop. Now, the entry and exit points out of the lymphatic system are the lymph nodes. So here you've got lymph nodes under the arm, under the chin, hip and thigh, groin area, and behind the knee. So for instance, when the acid leaves a lymph node here under the arm, it's not going to go via the bloodstream to a fat cell here in the lower leg because that's going to acidify the bloodstream on the way down. So very quickly, as soon as the acid leaves this lymph node here, it's going to go to a fat cell in this area. So that might mean back of the arm, bra strap area. Same thing here under the chin, you get the double chin. And here as well, stomach, hip, and groin. So now you start getting the stomach and the fat around the thigh area. So these areas are now getting bigger in size. Now, apart from that happening on those parts of the system, the hormone leptin that is supposed to turn fat into energy now cannot get through this water barrier over there, which now means you cannot turn these fat cells into energy anymore. And you'll notice this when you start going to the gym and go on diets. You'll notice that you lose the weight here from your face, the rings get looser around your fingers, the watches get looser around your wrists, but you never seem to lose the weight from the stomach, hip and thighs, and all of these problem areas. So you literally go from being a big fat person to a small fat person because the shape of your body really doesn't change much at all. So let's think about it now. If you want to work smarter and not harder, what do you want to get rid of first over here to get your body to start burning the fat again? Absolutely right. You want to get rid of the acid because if there's no more acid around the fat cell, there's no need for that fluid to be there either. However, the plot thickens. Because if you've got a lot of fluid retention that's building up under your skin, remember that your skin runs in a grid pattern like this. So when you've got all this fluid retention that's pushing into the gaps of the grid, you get that very uneven skin tone appearance, mostly for the ladies, and we call that what? You guessed it, cellulite. Now again, I've done the research extensively over the past 13 years, and again, this is something I'd like to share with you just to make you realize that if you've got cellulite, that does not mean that your body is fat. Cellulite is not fat, it is the state of your fat cells, and this is why you'll see skinny girls with skinny legs
with the dimples in the back of the thighs, not that they're overweight, but that they've got a lot of acid around the fat cells due to their lifestyles. Now, cellulite would probably be best described as internal pollution. The regions in the body where cellulite is most commonly visible is on the thighs, buttocks, tops of arms, and around the abdomen. This is because our natural internal cleansing system stores the toxins in the fatty tissues far away from the vital organs. The toxins cause the circulation to slow down, and the skin eventually has a puckered orange peel look to it. Cellulite is no ordinary fat and cannot be eliminated by diet or exercise alone. Again, if you're thinking about just exercising on its own and you increase the size of the muscle, that compression is going to get worse, which means that's going to push more into your grid and your cellulite gets worse. Now again, if you're a man, we're not going to get cellulite the same as a woman because our lymph nodes run a little bit differently. Our lymph nodes run through this way, a woman's lymph nodes run through that way because they carry the child in this area. So for men, we get that big stomach. You poke that stomach and it's kind of hard to the touch. And women kind of get the cellulite. So for men, we end up looking like an olive on toothpicks. And for women, their skin looking like old wet bread. That's the difference between men and women. Now, think about it. If you've got a lot of pressure pushing up into the skin that way, obviously this pressure is now going to push downwards as well. Now, if you look at what's going straight to the center of your body over there, this is called your bloodstream. So let's have a look. That's where the lymph nodes are. Let's have a look at where your major blood vessels are in your body. Have a look at that. That's your inferior vena cava and the aorta, your major blood vessels. So if you've got a lot of pressure pushing against those blood vessels, what's happening to your blood pressure levels? I've seen countless guests and clients over the years that have high blood pressure problems, but their cholesterol is low. How can you have high blood pressure if your cholesterol is low and there's nothing to block up your artery? Because that pressure is pushing down into your blood vessels, and your doctor very cleverly then wants to give you a diuretic or a water tablet to try and get rid of that fluid. So then you go and pee all night long trying to get rid of that water, but you'll find that the next day all that fluid is returned in order to protect your fat cells. That water has to be there to protect the fat cell. I hope that makes sense for everybody. So now finally the diuretic doesn't work anymore, and now you're on your blood pressure medication. Now you're on your beta blocker. Now for most people, it starts with blood pressure and goes on to the next one, to do with the fatty levels in your blood. We call that a cholesterol problem. Now again, if you're one of these people that think you've got to start cutting out fats out of your diet, and fat is the prime cause of cholesterol, you're sorely mistaken. Very simply put, what happens is your liver produces LDL cholesterol. Again, LDL is now supposed to be the bad molecule, and because it's the bigger one of the two. HDL is a small little molecule, LDL is a big molecule. Now what happens is when your bloodstream becomes acidic, when there's a lot of acid in your bloodstream, imagine this acid can start eating through your arterial walls. And if there's a hole in your artery and you die from internal bleeding, this isn't going to be very good for your body. So very simply, your brain sends a signal to the liver saying, listen, please increase the production of LDL cholesterol to act as a binding agent to pull this excess acid out of the bloodstream. Now again, LDL is a bigger molecule. It's got a much bigger surface area to latch onto more acid to pull it out of your bloodstream. So wherever the cholesterol then has damaged your artery, that's where the cholesterol lays down, and that's where the blockage inside the artery, now you've got a blockage and you've got high cholesterol. So when you take your statin drug, very simply the statin drug stops the production of LDL cholesterol in the liver, and now you first of all lose your defense mechanism against the acid, and secondly, every 6 months now you've got to go for liver tests because statin drugs are so toxic to the body that they've got to check that your liver is still functioning okay. So that's a very, very simple explanation of what causes cholesterol inside your body. So we've got blood pressure, cholesterol, and again, if you look around the population today, the United States, Australia, and the United Kingdom, the third one that is plaguing us today is something called diabetes. There's over 50 million Americans today that don't even know that they are pre-diabetic. Now, why do you think this might happen? Well, let's think about it, because now your liver has got no access to the primary fuel source because the hormone leptin can't get to that fat cell. So your body needs to produce a fuel source or an alternative fuel source, and the liver kicks in and produces glucose as an alternative fuel source. So now your blood glucose levels are elevated throughout the day. Your pancreas have to secrete more insulin daily to pull that sugar out of your bloodstream. You become insulin resistant, and now a diabetic process begins to develop inside your body. Now you're pre-diabetic, you got to go on your metformin or whatever it might be they want to put you on,
So now you've got blood pressure, cholesterol, and diabetes. Now these three all fall under one banner called heart disease. Now statistically, one in two will die from heart disease. From those that are left over, one in three will die from cancer. These are absolutely shocking statistics. Now again, let's go back 100 years. Take that hamburger from today, compare it to that hamburger from 100 years. What's the main difference in the two? Yep, again, it's the chemicals that's been put in that food and our environment that is causing these conditions inside your system. Now please remember, if you are not overweight today, if you're watching this and you're not fat, you're not overweight, that does not mean that your body is not toxic. Because everyone is born genetically with a certain amount of fat cells that either get bigger or smaller. You don't get more or less fat cells, they just grow or shrink in size. Now, if genetically you don't have a lot of fat cells for the acid to be put in, the other part of your body that's made up of predominantly fat is the brain and the nerves of your body. So when these toxins or the acid is then deposited into the brain tissue, the neural tissue, this can now be called a neurotoxic chemical. So I find that skinnier people will still have the cholesterol problems because, again, this affects their bloodstream. But also they start suffering more from things like Parkinson's, senility, dementia, Alzheimer's, tingling, palpitations, all of these kinds of conditions. Because, again, fat is actually a defense mechanism against all of this acid coming inside your system. I know this is hard to believe for most of you, but this is the way your body operates into protecting itself against this acidity. So now you've got your conditions here, your blood pressure, cholesterol, diabetes, whatever it might be, and your body now is in a state of despair. So now you go to the doctor and you say, "Doc, listen, I'm not feeling too good. I've got no energy. I've got a ton of weight in my body. What can I do to get off these medications, get my body back to health?" And what does the doctor then tell you to do? Yep, you guessed it. Go to the gym and exercise. Now again, this is what I was doing earlier on in my career. I would get guests like these and I'd say, "Hey man, you need to start exercising. We need to get you in the gym. So we need to get you to pump some iron, run around." And what happens when you do all these exercises and all of these movements? Your muscles produce a waste product called lactic acid. More acid in an already acidic body. And you don't have to be a rocket scientist to think that this is not a good idea. Now you'll notice that this acid that's building up inside your muscles now cannot drain away properly because your drain is clogged. Right, your lymphatic system is clogged up, the drain is clogged, this acid cannot drain properly. Now if your body holds on to that lactic acid inside the muscle for too long, that can start to cause aches and pains and damage inside your muscles. And again, your body really doesn't want that to happen. So very simply, your body is going to have to start drawing on its own alkaline reserves to buffer against this acidity. So again, if you're not familiar with chemistry, acid and alkaline together create a neutral. Your body can rather deal with a neutral than it can with an acid. So let's think about it. Which part of the body is made up of mostly alkaline? You guessed it, the bone structure. Your bones is made up of calcium. Calcium is a very high alkaline mineral. So the body literally starts taking calcium from the bones and puts it by this acid over here to neutralize or buffer against that acid. And then you'll start noticing that calcification starts to occur around your muscles. When this starts to happen, this is now what you would call a trigger point or a knot. So you go to your massage therapist and they massage your muscles and they put their elbows and their thumbs into these knots and break down the calcification and your body starts to feel good again for a few days. But the process starts to happen all over again a couple of days later because you still haven't unclogged your drain. Now over the long term, let's think about it carefully. What do you call that disease where your body keeps taking bone mass or calcium out of the bones and the bones become more brittle and you start to lose height? Yes, we call that osteoporosis. Now please remember that if you are losing height today because of osteoporosis, it's not because you're trying to make your way back down to the ground as you're approaching the end of your life. Your body is literally trying to protect you against the acidity. Your body is saying to you, "Hey man, please help me. I've got so much acid, I've got to break myself down to keep you alive." Now, if you look at arthritis, which joint is normally the first one that is affected by arthritis? The knees, right? Not because the knees are weight-bearing, but because every big joint has got a big pocket of what's called synovial fluid. Synovial fluid is a very, very high alkaline fluid. So again, very simply, your body takes this acid away from the organs to the lymph nodes behind your knee, and via those lymph nodes, the acid goes into the knee joint to be neutralized. The crystals that then form in the joint breaks down your knee joint.
And after a few years, now you've got no more cartilage left and you're now bone on bone. Now you've got really sore and painful knees. You've got to go to the doctor and you've got to make a very hefty contribution to the orthopedic surgeon's BMW fund because now he's got to give you two new knees. Then it moves up here to the hips because there's lymph nodes there. Then here to the shoulder because there's lymph nodes there. So arthritis is always in the knees, hips, and shoulders. What you'll notice then is that because your body's breaking down the calcium to neutralize against this acid, your blood calcium levels are elevated. And again, if your body has to calcify the organs, your heart, lungs, kidney now gets calcified, you're going to be in big trouble. So the body wants to keep that calcium away from the organs, and the points that are furthest away from the organs in your body is your hands, your feet, and here in the neck. So you'll notice that you get these little swollen knuckles here on the tip of the finger. Now you've got this calcification developing here. You're getting old, you've got arthritis in the hand, you've got bone spurs growing here in your foot. You can't just grow a new bone, that calcium's got to come from somewhere, right? Then you've got the nerve channels here getting blocked up in your neck, you're getting tingling in your hands, tingling in the feet, all because of this calcification that's building up because your body's breaking down its own calcium reserves to protect you against the acid and keep you alive. So again, in a very short period of time, I've described something that we can mostly call the aging process, right? This is your body's aging. Now, unfortunately, this process doesn't end here because now the acid will start to affect your blood cells. Now, this is something that's really, really important because once the acid affects your blood, now you're going to be in real trouble. Imagine that these are two blood cells right over here. The structure of a blood cell is such that you've got a positive charge on the inside of the blood cell and a negative charge on the outside of the blood cell. This is where the magnetism part comes in that I was talking about in the beginning of the presentation. The reason why cells have got negative charges is so they can push each other away. Very similar to if you take two magnets. The negative ends will cause the cells to repel, or the magnets to repel. The reason why they've got to repel is because blood cells have to go through the capillaries to take oxygen in single file. So some capillaries are so small that only one blood cell at a time can get through to take oxygen to those parts of the body. Now, when you've got too much acid inside your body, too much positive charges in your bloodstream, this positive charge is going to strip this negative charge, and now look, you've got a negative and a positive, which means these two blood cells are going to stick together. When that starts happening, oxygen is reduced in your body, and what's going to happen to your energy levels? Through the floor. Now I've got no more energy, chronically fatigued, can't get out of bed, I don't feel like living life anymore, I'm always tired. Secondly, when you've got blood cells that stick together, what is a risk factor for you? Thrombosis, stroke, and so forth. Thirdly, those capillaries that can only allow one blood cell at a time now can't get enough oxygen. So when those capillaries can't get oxygen, what's going to happen to them? Obviously starve to death, right? Because there's no oxygen. Your body really doesn't want that to happen, though. Your body doesn't want any part of you to die while you are still alive. So very simply, your body switches from using oxygen as a primary fuel source to fermenting sugar or glucose as an alternative energy system. Now, when this happens, there is a mutation that is associated with that shift in energy systems. And again, if you think carefully, which disease is associated with mutation or cellular mutation? Absolutely right. Cancer. Cancer today, the statistic is 1 in 3. 100 years ago, the statistic was about 1 in 2,000. Now, what is the difference between today and then? Okay, if a cow is still a cow grazing in the field, if a chicken is still a chicken, and if an apple is still an apple, what's the difference between then and now? Again, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure out it must be the amount of chemicals we're putting into our body on a daily basis. Now, again, this is not something I've just made up or sucked out of my thumb over the last few months. This was actually discovered in 1931 by a German doctor called Otto Warburg, who actually won 2 Nobel Prizes for his discovery. Now, in 1931, Dr. Warburg won his first Nobel Prize for proving that cancer is caused by a lack of oxygen respiration in cells. He stated in an article titled "The Prime Cause and Prevention of Cancer" that the cause of cancer is no longer a mystery, and we know it occurs whenever any cell is denied 60% of its oxygen requirements. Summarized in a few words, the prime cause of cancer is the replacement of the respiration of oxygen in normal body cells by a fermentation of sugar. All normal body cells meet their energy needs by respiration of oxygen, whereas cancer cells meet their energy needs in great part by fermentation. Poor oxygenation comes from a buildup of carcinogens and other toxins within and around the cells, which blocks and then damages the cellular oxygen respiration mechanism. Again, look at this fluid retention that is cutting off blood circulation to the surface of the skin. How many people today are getting skin cancer without going in the sun? Or lung cancer without even smoking? So cut off oxygen to a cell and you run the risk of developing a malignancy in your body. Now, again, if you take a guy like Lance Armstrong, the famous cyclist who won the Tour de France 7 times, amazing athlete, and I'm sure you'll all agree with me that this guy was super healthy. He ate only the best food, he exercised every day, he didn't drink, he didn't smoke, and yet developed testicular cancer. Now, when I found out that Lance Armstrong's got cancer, I thought, well, what's the point of being healthy? Let's just all be fat and happy, drink and smoke. We're going to die anyway. There's nothing we can do to protect ourselves against that terrible disease. But then I started thinking to myself, what was he doing every single day in the form of exercise? He was sitting on a saddle, which was cutting off blood circulation to the testes, and those cells literally just had to switch to fermenting glucose, and that's what might have caused his malignancy inside of his body. Now, please remember that obviously genetics play a big part in this. And wherever there's a genetic weakness inside your body, the acid is going to go there first. And in Lance's case, the testicles were the first ones to be affected by the lack of oxygen going to those cells. Now, please, guys, please, if you're listening to this, this process does not skip anyone. Not me, not you, nobody. I read a book that's close to my heart, and in that book it says that my people will perish without knowledge. Let them who have ears hear. Never again can you say you didn't know. Please do not be in a position where you say to yourself, I should have, I could have, but I didn't. The biggest toxin you can put into your body is regret. So with that being said, how many of you are now ready to start removing all of this acidity out of your body? I'm hoping that that's you, because we need to start looking at a better life, a better quality of life in terms of having an acid-free lifestyle. So if you're still wondering what detox is all about, this is it. We got to get rid of this acidity. So once you get rid of acid, you're going to start losing this fluid retention around your fat cells. You're going to start getting oxygen back into your blood cells. You're going to start cleaning out your drain to boost your immune system. Your liver is going to start functioning better again. Less osteoporosis, less breakdown of the bone structure, less trigger points, aches and pains in your muscles, more vitality, more energy, and you're pretty much taking out an insurance policy to prevent your body from breaking down in terms of chronic conditions. So please, don't be fooled. By putting all of this acid inside your body, you really are running the risk of any of these conditions that I developed or spoke about here today. So in the next part of this DVD, we're going to go into exactly how to cleanse your body and get yourself back to a state of good health by very, very easily removing this acidity. Stay tuned. Right, so now after that explanation, I'm sure you realize that it's pretty important for you to start living an acid-free lifestyle. Now, remember what we said. Apart from the chemicals that is causing acidity in your body, there are a few other foods as well that we consume as a population on a regular basis that is very, very acid-forming to our body. That includes meats, any animal product, meat, eggs, and milk. Please take a note of that. Meat, eggs, and milk are very, very acid-forming to your body. If you eat meat on a regular basis, especially if you eat meat late at night after, say, 6 p.m., you're letting your body in for a lot of trouble. The reason is, I need you guys to remember now, we're going to elaborate on this a little bit later when we come to the actual detoxification part of this program, but your body works on what's called a circadian rhythm. So when you wake up in the morning, your body now focuses on digestion and assimilation, and this is why we have usually a big breakfast, a break fast. You're breaking the fast from while you were sleeping the night before. This is supposed to be the biggest meal of the day. If you want to have meat, you want to have eggs, you want to have those types of food, have it earlier on in the day. Remember that you're always going to eat for what you are going to be doing, not for what you have done. So, what happens is you wake up in the morning and your digestive tract is now geared and switched on towards digestion and assimilation. So whatever you eat, you will break down and assimilate and use for the different metabolic functions in your body.
Now, for instance, if you have a big steak at night, you have a steak and then you go to sleep a couple of hours later, it takes about up to 8 hours for your body to digest and break down a steak. Now, in the evening time when you're supposed to be sleeping and resting, your digestive system and your liver switches over to detoxification. So phase one and phase two of liver function and liver cleansing means that you're basically going to be breaking down toxins while you sleep, cleaning up from the day's activities, if you were, a simple explanation. So if you're eating a big meal that takes a long time to digest, meat, eggs, milk, your body is not getting a chance to detoxify, cleanse, and break down the acidity that you've accumulated across throughout the day. Now, milk especially, please take note, milk is a poison to the human body. You are not supposed to be drinking cow's milk. The human gut is not designed to digest and break down cow's milk, rather have sheep's or goat's milk. Milk is literally poison to your system. Now, what happens to your body? Once that you've got so much acidity in your lymphatic system, so remember what we said, the lymphatic system is the drain. So there's your drain is clogged. Your body now has to do something with this acidity, and your body stores this acid around the fat cells. So when the acid sits around your fat cell, this is basically irritation that's irritating that cell. Irritation irritates. So your body has to respond to that irritation. Now imagine that you inhaled black pepper or dust or pollen or something that irritates your nasal passage. What does your nose produce as a protective mechanism against this irritation? When you sneeze and you blow it out your nose, yes, it's called mucus. Now the same thing happens here. The body's solution to pollution is dilution, but it's always going to be in the form of mucus because the acid irritates that cell, and this mucus is now surrounding your fat cell. Now, first of all, if you've got a whole bunch of fat cells with mucus, you can see how that's going to create that uneven skin tone, giving you cellulite. But let's take it a step further. When you have a cold, blow your nose into that tissue, have a look what's in that tissue, and imagine that you're carrying anywhere between 5, 10, 15, 20, 30, 40, I don't know how many pounds of snot that you're carrying around your fat cells and around the connective tissues of your body. Now, for those of you that have ever been to an acupuncturist or a traditional Chinese healer, they will refer to this as dampness. It's like a river of mud flowing through connective tissues of your body. The Indian Ayurvedic culture refers to this as ama. Basically, it's snot, it's mucus, and it's more acid forming in your body. It slows down your system, and it's not very good for your health. You can imagine what that's going to make you look like as well. So when we're talking about detoxifying the body, anybody can go and take a whole bunch of herbal laxatives and sit in a toilet for a week and cleanse their colon. But this is not really what we're talking about, because remember that your body accumulates or bioaccumulates all of those toxins and acidity and stores it in certain tissues and parts of your body. So when you really want to cleanse, your body needs to be able to break down these fat-soluble toxins, get rid of that acidity around the cells, so that your body can now break down this mucus and pass it out of your system through the bowels, through the urinary tract, and get rid of it through those channels of your body. So when we talk about cleansing, we want to get rid of that mucus. We want to start cleansing the bloodstream. We want to start cleansing the liver, the kidneys, the lymphatic system, the fat cells of your body, even the brain tissue. Because remember what we said, that you are all born genetically with a certain amount of fat cells. So if genetically you don't have a lot of fat cells, the other parts of your body where the acid will affect you is your blood, your muscles, even your brain and nervous system. So please, be aware of the amount of acidity that you've got in your lifestyle. Remember that when you cleanse, we want to get rid of this mucus around the connective tissues and around your organs, around your cells, so that your body can be functioning a lot better. Again, if you want a little bit more information about this specific subject, about the mucus around the cells, I recommend reading the book Clean by Dr. Alejandro Younger. It's an amazing book explaining this whole principle about how the mucus builds up around your cells. So let's have a look. We've got a lot of mucus around the cells. We want to start breaking down these toxins and acidity and getting our body back to a state of good health. Now let's think about this logically, because you don't need to be a rocket scientist to figure out that acidity is going to affect your health adversely. You know, everybody wants to focus and specialize in such small areas that
they miss the big picture in life, right? So we've got a lot of chemicals and acidity, toxins, we want to get rid of them. So if acid's the problem, what do you want to put back into your body?
Yep,
alkalinity. Very simple. You want to put a lot of alkaline back into your body. Also, what you want to put back is oxygen. You want to put a lot of oxygen back into your body because oxygen promotes and creates life inside your body. You need oxygen in your blood cells to survive. You also need frequency or energy. The energy is there, again, to help your organs function better and to give your body the electricity or electrical charges that it needs to function properly. And lastly, again, we need hydrogen. Hydrogen in the body to keep the cells healthy on a cellular level. Now, again, you might be wondering, why do I say you need hydrogen? Again, let's go back to the argument I made a few moments earlier about cancer. Now, again, cancerous cells do not contain hydrogen atoms. When healthy cells have plenty of hydrogen, they cannot become cancerous. If we can get hydrogen into any unhealthy cell, they can heal. So again, we want a lot of oxygen, we want a lot of hydrogen. Now remember what I said in the beginning of the presentation. Who can remember what is the three things that the body functions on? Electricity, chemistry, and magnetism. So when you look at these four elements over here, alkalinity will be the magnetism part of this, oxygen will be the chemistry part of this, frequency and hydrogen will be chemistry, magnetism, chemistry, and the frequency will be electricity. So magnetism, chemistry, electricity, chemistry. So this is what your body needs to work on. Now, magnetism, chemistry, electricity, and chemistry again. So let's have a look now. So why is alkalinity important in your body? Why do you need to put alkaline foods back in your body? What does that got to do with acidity? Remember that acid has a positive charge. So if you take two magnets, two negative ends of magnets will repel one another. Take a negative and a positive and they will attract one another. So again, if you want to attract the positive charges of the acidity in your bloodstream, you need to put a lot of negative charges into your body via the food that you're eating. So we need high alkaline food that's high in negative charges. A lot of oxygen again to keep your blood cells alive because you need oxygen to survive. Remember frequency, electricity. Now again, high alkaline foods are high in megahertz. This might be a concept that is very new to most of you again. When we talk about food, because a lot of you will still be focusing on protein, carbs, and fats, and the amount of calories that these nutrients bringing back into your body, or bringing into your body. Now, when we talk about true energy, we're talking about the electrical charges that your body absorbs from food. Now your organs need anywhere between 60 to 90 megahertz to function properly. So the liver, the kidneys, the heart, the lungs need 60 to 90 megahertz of electrical charges absorbed from the food. Most food today that you buy, like say for instance a Big Mac, has got about 3 megahertz, or a piece of chocolate cake has got about 4 megahertz. Very, very low in megahertz or electrical charges. You can give this another name and call it qi. So again, we go back to the Chinese. The Chinese call this qi. The life force flowing to your body. What is life force? It's the amount of electrical charges that you absorb from your food. So when you eat foods that are devoid of electrical charges, it's going to cost you a lot more to digest and break down that food than what it's actually giving you. So this is again why we have high alkaline food or detoxification cleansing food, high in electrical charges. So again, this is to make your organs function better again. Now hydrogen again, we said that's chemistry. Why do we need hydrogen? Again, to keep your cells healthy. So this is why we need all of these alkalinity, oxygen, frequency, and hydrogen into your body to have a nice cleansing diet, cleansing lifestyle to get rid of the acidity. So alkalinity, oxygen, frequency, and hydrogen. So you might be asking to yourself now, okay, well, what is foods that contain all of these four elements? Very, very simply put, there's a few different foods, and most of these can be found on the acid and alkaline food list, which you'll be getting at the end of this presentation as well. So when you look at your acid and alkaline food list, you'll see that there's foods like cucumber, broccoli, and yep, you guessed it, it's all your green vegetables. So if you don't like green vegetables, this is what you're going to have to start focusing on to get a much better lifestyle and get your health back as well. But the highest alkaline foods The food that contains most of all four of these is what we call algae and grasses. So your grasses like wheatgrass, barley grass, algae like spirulina, chlorella, ascophyllum, laminaria, Klamath Lake. These are different types of algae that the human body absorbs very, very well. Now the reason again why I say algae is a very, very good food to be putting inside your system to cleanse and rejuvenate your system is because it's very, very high in alkalinity. Algae is 98% alkaline. Through the process of photosynthesis produces oxygen and frequency, very, very high in frequency. Again, algae contains about 260 to 290 megahertz. Now remember that your organs need 60 to 70, and this is giving you 260 plus in frequency. And again, 98% pH stands for potential hydrogen, 98% potential hydrogen. So again, a lot of hydrogen you're getting into your body through algae and grasses as well. Now please remember, this is very important as well. There is a similarity between the size of chlorella or algae and our red blood cells and the function and structure of algae and our hemoglobin. These two are vital to the life of the organism to which they belong. In clinical uses, chlorella tonifies our blood. The high DNA and RNA content of chlorella can be the building blocks for our DNA and RNA, which is the building block of all living things. We are able to utilize these nucleic acids for cell rejuvenation. Dr. Benjamin Frank uses high DNA and RNA foods to assist these patients in restoring youthful and energetic appearance. He also discovered that health problems such as arthritis, emphysema, heart disease, deteriorating vision, memory loss, depression simply disappeared with the intakes of these foods. Now I think that if you can get foods, if you look at your acid alkaline food list, your high alkaline foods, if you can put this into your body in abundance and start removing all of this acidity, all you really got to focus on is getting foods with a lot of negative charges in it. Alkaline foods is going to give you all these other four combined with it. Now let's have a look again. Let's take a look what's going to happen. When you start detoxifying your body, what exactly is it that you can expect from a cleanse? Because results is what we're after. So remember we said there's a fat cell. For those of you that want to lose weight, when you start detoxifying your body, you're going to be getting rid of this mucus, okay? So what's going to happen when you go to the toilet, apart from the fecal matter that you're going to get rid of, there's a lot of mucus that's going to be coming out as well. For those of you that have seen pictures or photographs of this, sometimes it looks like part of the colon that's come out the rear end of that person. It's not that it's fecal matter, it's mucus that sits on the wall of the colon that drips down and then passes out of the body. And once that starts happening, you can imagine how much more energy, vitality, wonderful skin tone that you're going to have from all of the acid that's no longer there from detracting from your health. So listening to this presentation from the beginning, we've spoken for about an hour and a half now about how acidity breaks the body down. It causes most, 95%, maybe even more, of all clinical and chronic diseases, including cancer, diabetes, blood pressure, and cholesterol. It breaks down your bone structure, it detracts from your energy, it detracts from your quality of life. So I hope this has given you a little bit of an explanation as to how to get your body back to a good state of health. Once you focus on your health, I promise you that your weight loss is going to follow as well. Now in the next part of the DVD, what I'm going to show you as well is how to exercise to improve your posture. Because a lot of people think that just by going on the treadmill, they're improving their health and they're going to start getting their body back to where it needs to be, but this is not always the case. I'm sure there are some of you out there that have tried every single diet, you've tried every single exercise program. Please, start cleansing your body now. When you combine cleansing with nutrition and then with exercise, you're going to set yourself up for much, much better results. Don't be like that fly that keeps on flying with head first into that window. Jenny Craig, Weight Watchers, everyone's tried those and not always with great success. So start cleansing first. Focus on good food, and then we're going to start looking at exercise so you can start changing the shape of your body as well. Remember that exercise will not make you lose weight, but we can change the shape of your body by looking out for your posture as well. Exercise should be there again for the shape of your body through posture and for strengthening the heart muscle. So I'd like to thank you for listening to me for the past hour and a half. It's been a wonderful experience. I hope you've taken away a lot of what I've said and realize how important it is to cleanse your body and live an acid-free life. And I wish you all the best. I'm always there with you. We'll see you at the other end.